Hello and welcome back to Mask of the Plague Doctor by Peter Parish with me, Barton. We're on chapter 12, From Wakeful Thread to Dream of Sleep. He may develop a soreness of the throat, but that is the only detriment observed to date. If there are any further questions... Alice looks to the assembled group of clergy and sanctuary workers gathered beneath the ceiling of your cella laboratory. The scattering of vials on the bench before her represents a combination of your efforts to wring as much as possible from what little white lichen you had remaining, enough for the infirmary attendant standing before you, and a narrow selection of citizens from the streets above.
What about the others?
Asks a woman with green monk's hood pulled back.
I count 24 elixirs. What of the rest of our town?
Does it even matter?
Sniffs a morose older man at her side.
We've all heard the reports. Baron Moreland will be upon us by the next cycle of the sun, putting us to the sword in the crown's name.
Not if we can convince him the plague can be halted, you reply. An outright cure eludes us still, but this, you gesture at the vials, this may forestall his purge.
You have been selected because... We believe you have the most exposure to the waking death, Alice explains. Those in service of the sanctuary will receive the first doses. The few remaining vials will be distributed among selected members of the population until we are able to gather further ingredients. This is the best we can do.
Sounds like we're to be an experiment, grumbles someone from near the back of the room.
Ioko stands tall, trying to peer at the owner of the voice.
An experiment of which you are all fortunate to be a part, says Alice. Though if you wish to deny yourself protection from this plague, you are welcome to leave this room.
She pauses, waiting to see whether anybody will choose to move. When they do not, she continues.
Very well, we are ready to begin. Gamel, will you aid me?
I accept, eager to distribute the fruits of our medical labor. I decline maintaining with the distance again. If something goes awry, except keen to protect the sages about clergy, I decline muttering with pessimism to safety of this concoction. I accept, eager to distribute the fruits of our medical labors.
Ioka remains behind the bench as you and Alice move back and forth among the attendees. Your application of doses proceeds without a snag, save for a peculiarly tall monk who has to be encouraged to stoop before he can hold the elixir properly to his mouth.
But like the rest, he is soon imbibing the liquid within. A long cough raises your nerves. You tense in place, hoping it will pass, counting off silent beats. Another cough follows, lighter than the first. Then all is settled and still. Alice gives your arm a congratulatory pat on her way to returning the last empty vial to the bench.
What now?
One of the clergy asks.
Your participation is complete, and you may return to your duties, Alice replies. Leave the rest to us.
The attendees begin to depart.
With a shuffle of robes and limbs, your audience begins to file out through the laboratory doorway.
Even if this works as intended, Ioko says, can we convince Moreland it is enough?
The fate of the town may depend upon it, Alice sighs. As ever, people's trust in medical progress will come down to the charming cadence of a peddler's pitch.
Not that you're at all bitter about that, you remark.
Still, Alice continues, this is cause for hope. Once more of the white lichen is in our possession, we can halt the rate of infection. But for now, we must find a way to treat those whom the plague still torments.
You think about those still suffering within the infirmary. The chance of an outright cure seems closer than the day you passed beneath Dunbar Hollow's gates, but Moreland's advance will leave you no room for experimentation, nor for error. If there is to be any breakthrough, it must come at speed. Consider your options.
You inhale the air of the sanctuary courtyard, allowing it to fill your lungs. The dipping afternoon sun casts the last rays of a winter afternoon across the grass. You breathe deep once more, closing your eyes for a moment, taking advantage of a rare day where the milder air does not leave a burning chill in your throat. The stone edifice of the courtyard well feels secure against your back, and you stretch your legs at the scent of moss and watery gruel reaches your nose. Behind you, seated upon the rim of the covered well, Alice stirs her pallid soup. The wooden utensil clacks against the side of the bowl in distracted rhythm. "So," Ayoko says, you turn your head to the side in order to see him. The surgeon stands, arms folded, hip resting against the cylindrical funnel of the well. Oh, I thought he was saying that. "Are we ready to commit?" The stirring sound ceases. "We have no other choice," you hear Alice say before she alights from the edge of the well. Your brief respite from duty is at an end. There's no further time for research or investigation. Your colleagues are right. If you are ever to produce a cure for the waking dead, you must make the attempt now. Where's Eowyn? We still have time to learn why his sect resists the plague. I've heard it said that root of mandrake can ease the symptoms. That's our best chance. What if the silent monks in the cellar could furnish us with a cure? Only one deity has the power. Okay, dismiss that. Our knowledge is slim, but if we combine what we know, we may find fortune. We cannot make a cure, we must flee. Okay, dismiss that one. So dismiss the fourth one and the sixth one, which leaves us the rest. So, Eowyn... Where's Eowyn? We still have time to learn why his sect resists the plague. I've heard it said that the root of the mandrake can ease the symptoms. That's our best chance. Silent monks, possible. Knowledge slim. This is tough. I think the Eowyn thing, I think for them it might be because the lichen is something already related to them. Could be wrong though, because there was the white flower, which might actually be the mandrake. Yeah, this one is tough. I'm going to say, I really want to just say, let's combine our thoughts and do it that way and hope that that includes mandrake and whatever the guys have. But not sure with that. So what we do, I think he would put forward mandrake. So let's do that. I've heard it said that root of the mandrake can ease the symptoms. That's our best chance. The pages of the Trotula give mandrake roots almost mythical properties, Alice says. From whom did you hear that it could fend off the waking dead? You describe your strange encounter with the man confined to the rooms above the infirmary. A man whose tongue can barely comprehend, and you may have misunderstood you in kind, Ayoko says. I can scarce conceive of a source more credible. The absurdity is not lost upon me, you reply. Were our need not so pressing, I may not have brought it up, but unless you have a compelling suggestion of your own, this is the closest reference we have to some form of cure. It may not be as outlandish as it first appears, Alice muses. The Trotulus considers root of mandrake to be a sedative. Mind you, it also claims a plant will emit a fatal shriek if plucked from the earth. I believe I can put that claim to rest, Ayoko pats around on his belt, settling at last on a battered leather pouch. Didn't make so much as a peep when I took it from Sybil Blake's garden. That is, if it truly is mandrake. The servant tending the plant suffered only her word. What else did you get up to during our visit to the manor, you ask, wondering about the other periods of time when the surgeon was out of your sight. A mere thank you would suffice, he replies, handing the pouch across to Alice. She weighs the container in her hand and gives an appreciative nod. Once crushed to powder, this amount should go far, she says. Your pilfering fingers may have been guided by unwitting foresight, old man. Nothing unwitting about it. Once the gardener began gushing about the rarity of such a plant,
My mind was resolved.
Prepare your prospective cure.
Gather around a single cathar central bench in the cellar laboratory. The three of you work with the mandrake root to prepare a remedy for those enduring torments in the infirmary above. With no time now to organize tests or experiments, you're forced to rely on prior experience, fragments of conflicting research, and qualified intuition.
Individual dosage should be low, Alice says. A dusting or of crushed root at most.
If we see positive effects, we can increase the amount according to our observation. But our patients do not have the constitution for anything greater.
And how should it be applied? Ayoko asks. Were we to create a concoction, I am not confident all will be able to swallow it.
The trotula claims an application of the root to a person's abdomen is a treatment for restless slumber, she replies, her head turns to cheek.
Check the page of the tome, but you are certain she has recalled this knowledge with accuracy.
Then perhaps a poultice, or salve of sorts, you suggest.
I think it best, Alice nods, especially for those who stand closer to death's embrace, but we should prepare potions of more direct concentration for those infected in more recent cycles.
The talk fades as the three of you dredge your drained minds, dedicating every scrap of attention to the necessary preparations. During a rare moment of rest, you find yourself looking at your colleagues, each committed to their purpose and throwing themselves into this final chance to rid Tharmac Hollow of its wretched blight. You work on until dusk. The sky is a darkening swirl of oranges and purples as you cross the sanctuary courtyard towards the doors of the infirmary. You place your crate of containers at your feet, pausing by the side of the well to look up and admire the palette left by the dying light.
It's not our last sunset, Alice's voice is resolute.
I'd say it's a first of sorts, you say, turning to her and holding the open crate back into your arms.
The first for a town that now has a cure for the waking dead. There's a dull chink from the vials inside.
Come on, Ayoko says. The others are waiting.
At the infirmary entrance, summoned by the word of your intentions, stand Abbot Quelm and Prioress Marilda. You see their eyes move to the contents of your crate.
Have your endeavors succeeded? Marilda asks. Will this cure our citizens?
This is our sincere hope, Alice says. We must warn you, there is no guarantee. Until the treatment is administered, we cannot know for certain.
The Baron is preparing to bring destruction to this town, and those confined in the infirmary are in agony, the abbot says. Many would consider death to be a mercy.
They will have it if we do not act with haste, Ayoko says, casting a glance in the direction of Tharmac Hollow's sudden gate. With a nod of understanding, Quelm raises and releases the door's heavy knocker. Once, twice, thrice, the latches and locks are undone in succession, and the door swings open. The infirmary chamber is now far beyond capacity. Save for a few narrow avenues enforced by the clergy, every portion of the floor is covered by tattered and stained bedding, occupied by a patient in the perpetual clutches of wakeful torment. No longer can any of the afflicted roam the room. Instead, these rare, restless husks now shudder and rock at place, seated upon what few fragments of clothing they could gather or were donated by sympathetic attendants. An aroma of thick, feverish sweat clings to every surface. Despair fills every space. Ayoko mutters an exclamation of horror.
To work, Alice states, undeterred. Gamo, Ayoko, let us begin.
Do not his heart or actions have the blessings of would that the crown could see conditions in which people are forced to live. I say nothing, preparing the treatment.
Yeah.
Would that the crown could see the conditions in which its people are forced to live.
You move among the sick, urging calm as you encourage each patient to lift or open their robe enough to expose their abdomen, explaining that the salve
you are about to apply should ease their pain. You tilt the mandrake root concoction within the vial against a scrap of dense cloth, soaking it in the substance. Take care not to allow the liquid soak through your own glove. You wipe circular dose across their skin. When the vial is exhausted, you return to the open crate for another, then continue your methodical work. A battlefield would be easier on my nerves, Ayuko says as he places the last of his drained containers inside the wooden crate. He folds and then unfolds his arms, looking over the rows of the afflicted. The heel of his boot begins to tap against the floor.
How long do you suppose?
You watch Alice embark on another walk down one of the few remaining clear aisles, pausing to stoop and check certain patients with regularity that is beginning to look obsessive. Soon enough, you say, willing it to be true. The weight is having a tremendous effect upon your nerves. A few steps away, you see Marilda touching the back of her shaved head in anxious affectation. The abbot, his eyes shut tight, and you notice a slight movement to his lips. Ayoko nudges your arm with some urgency. In the near distance, beyond the first two rows of infected townsfolk, Alice is making frantic gestures, ushering you closer. As fast as you are able, you cross to her side. She points a woman at her feet, whose closed eyes and demeanor of serenity sends images of death racing through your scattered mind, until, in a gesture of clarity, Alice nods, holds up gloved finger near her own lips. You see now the woman's chest rise and fall, the fluttering lids of her eyes. She's sound asleep. Ayoko thrusts his arms aloft in hushed but heartfelt celebration. Almost overcome with relief, you embrace your colleagues in turn, feeling the rush of elation, wanting to shout out loud, yet not daring to interrupt such precious, hard-won slumber. Alice grasps your arm, waving you a few steps farther down the line of patients. There, a young man in the same dozing repose as the previous patient. As you look to your right, to your left, the eyelids of afflicted townsfolk are falling in rest.
We did it, Gamal,
Alice whispers, unable to keep the joy from her voice.
It's too soon to... Of course, the plague may yet leave its mark, but they're sleeping. We did it.
She raises a palm close to her mouth, trying in vain to contain her exuberance.
Didn't believe it possible,
Ayoko says in a hushed tone, shaking his head in amazement. He bends down by an older man, still needing to check the room's inhabitants are truly beginning to fall asleep.
I can't. Every obstacle was against us, but we really succeeded, he whispers to himself.
As you return towards the beaming pair of Abbot Quelm and Marilda, you're accompanied by the most beautiful uplifting chorus of snoring you have ever heard. Take a breath. Why do I get the feeling it's still going to end a disaster? I hope I'm wrong, but please let us be successful. Marilda sweeps you up in a sudden hug, her face beaming with admiration and relief. As you process the prioress's surprising show of warmth, your colleagues receive heartfelt congratulations from the abbot.
We should step outside, Alice insists, keeping your voice low, motioning to the rows of slumbering townsfolk.
As the sturdy infirmary door inches to a close behind you, she pulls the fox mask from her face, tossing it into the air with a purging cry of laughter. It lands back in her arms. She expels a sigh, deep and full of glee.
I have this horrible feeling that we're outside the room. Someone's going to come run out and tell us that they're starting to die or something's gone wrong.
Before we celebrate in earnest, there's still the Baron.
Ayoko's remark is halted by the dismissive reverberations of Alice's lips. She slips her mask back over her head.
We have fulfilled the dear Baron's task. The people are cured, thanks to our brilliance.
Not quite all, you remind her.
Those upstairs, yes,
Alice replies. We'll attend to them, too, of course. Moreland shall lift the siege. Food and trade will flow once more, and I shall be elevated to the Royal Fellowship. She gestures with a flourish towards the sanctuary gates.
Though the sooner we can inform him of our success, the better. We should hasten to the town walls.
Oko tarries in the courtyard. Why is Alice getting raised up and not anybody else, I wonder? Oko tilts his head toward Alice. She returns a nod and continues across the courtyard while the surgeon lingers by the well. He gestures for you to tarry with him.
I need to ask something of you before we parley with the Baron, he says, looking up as if to check whether anyone else is in earshot.
What is it?
I shall speak plain. If we share all of what we know of the Waking Death, the Crown will use that information for conquest and ill intent. I've seen as much.
He exhales, sending a cloud of mist into the early morning air.
I ask that you share only what is needed to free Thornbrick Hollow and no more. I beg you, do not allow them to use this plague as a weapon against others.
I don't give a shit about this Fellowship of Wild Physicians, so they can stuff that. Alice can have it if she wants. Things are done with us anyway. So, she's obviously married to her career. And off she goes. I'm not worried about that. I'll do all I can to help thwart the Crown's plans. You have my word. You misjudged the... No, I don't believe you misjudged. Perhaps certain aspects of our findings should be withheld in regards to medical safety. I'll do and say whatever is necessary to get me out of this town. So, ruling out that... So, 2 and 4 are the choices. I'll do all I can to help thwart the Crown's plans. You have my word. Medical safety. This one. Perhaps certain aspects of our findings should be withheld on the grounds of medical safety.
That may be the best way to present it to Alice,
Ayoko says, nodding his head.
She insists that a position with the Fellowship awaits her, and our efforts could jeopardize that ambition.
That position would be well deserved. The surgeon sighs.
That is so. She would improve any such organization. Yet, I fear no such reward exists. The Crown does not extend invitations to physicians of our standing.
Alice's voice calls to you from across the courtyard, querying your slot.
If we are united in our purpose, we can withhold important details and still have more than lift the siege, Ayoko says.
You exchange a shared nod of understanding before his long stride begins to carry him across the hardened earth.
Whatever the two of you were debating, you will have to wait, Alice says, directing you toward the archway leading Thornbrick Hollow's main thoroughfare.
I do not intend for this town to fall because we tarried too long by a frozen well. Come on!
Hasten to the sudden gate. Yeah, I'm getting really worried about her now. She's gonna screw everything over.
Donna still expelling even the lingering morning darkness as you approach the southernmost gate to the town.
In the pale light, you notice the increased number of guards stationed in the preparation for an attack. They sit in small groups, huddled around makeshift pyres. The red sashes laborers rub their hands for warmth. One spots your physician's attire and nudges the woman next to him.
Better found a cure mask, she calls after you, or else be ready to fight.
You acknowledge the comment with a raised hand, but do not slow your pace. Ahead stand the gates of Thornbrick Hollow, fashioned in oak and encased within a grand wooden gatehouse. A set of steps inside a structure of scaffolding leads back and forth in ascending diagonals. Atop the gatehouse resides the mechanism to seal or release the formidable doors.
Up there,
Ayoko says, pointing to sentries patrolling above.
When the Baron gets within earshot, we can address him from the gatehouse.
Your hand is on the first banister of the stairway when a familiar face hails your attention.
Are the ranks now so thin that they would force doctors in the front lines of battle?
Lucia, you say with a nod.
No, we intend to parley with Baron Morland. What are you doing here? It's great to see Lucy again. You can go away. And you can go away. Here we go.
I have a blade, they replied, gesturing back to at the fighters gathering around the small fires. I'm told that will make me useful.
You intend to fight? The laughter leaves the question open. Noticing that you now lag behind your ascending colleagues, you bid your mercenary companion a brief farewell. The floor of the gatehouse gantry creaks beneath your boots. Sentries move aside at the sight of your signed parchment of authority. As you look below, across the sparse winter lands outside Thornbrook Hollow, you see the extent of the threat arrayed before your adjusting eyes. Now, row upon row of yellow and black clad soldiers, pennants fluttering with erratic rhythm in the bluster of the morning wind. At their heart, a wheeled ram, its ramming pillar formed from the trunk of a gigantic felled oak.
So that's where their time has been spent, you hear Oracle mutter to himself.
Seated atop the lone horse in his command, Barlan Moreland parts the formation and directs the animal in a slow trot along the fine guard of his forces. The air trembles. You hear a distant rumble of thunder.
To the north.
Rattling the shape of the Cragscree Mountains.
You there,
Ioko calls to the older of two sentries, a woman shouldering a dilapidated crossbow.
Could you strike that man on the horse?
Once, maybe, she replies. If the bastard were close, and if I'd had any bolts.
So this crossbow is just for show?
Could still be for shooting, the sentry says. But the one scavenging for food needed them more.
She points in the vague direction of the mayoral manor.
Won't leave much of a squirrel or a rat behind, but it stops them moving. How do you think we stay fed? Shame though. I'd have fancied sticking a baron.
Bridget, the baron killer,
her companion sniffs. The two of them share a rasping chuckle as Ioka shakes his head.
He's riding our way, Alice remarks.
A cloak embroidered with the Moorland falcon billows behind the baron as he approaches the base of the gatehouse. He pulls on the reins, bringing the horse to a near stop from his canter.
Physicians, he calls out. Your arrival is most opportune. The Crown has directed me to reopen the trade route, and as their loyal servant, this is what I intend to do, one way or another.
He pauses, peering up at the sentries.
Lower that crossbow at once.
Yes, your baronship,
the woman says, all trace of her prior bravado now vanished. Let's see, it must be him.
Mere days under siege and already you would target your betters, the baron says, turning the horse
for another pass beneath your vantage point.
Discipline must be restored, that is,
he waves a hand,
if Thornbrook Hollow is yet free of plague. Tell me, physicians, have you rid these streets of the pestilence?
You lean closer to Alice, shielding the mouth of your mask with your hand. You should be honest with him. Tell him only.
I don't like any.
I thought we could just tell her. I guess tell him only what he wishes to hear is it, right? Is what we have to pick. We shouldn't be honest and tell him everything. Yeah.
He's bound to learn the truth in time,
she whispers back.
Well, I'd persist. Present this as best I can. Well?
The baron calls again.
How fare your efforts?
We've found a cure, Alice says. Call off the attack.
That is excellent news. Excellent news indeed,
Moreland replies.
I will have to verify your claim, of course, but tell me, have you also identified the source of this infection?
The source is known to us, you tell him.
Glad tidings indeed, he says. You have done well, very well indeed.
We have also pioneered an inoculation against further infection, Alice adds with pride.
Spectacular, the Baron says with a laugh. My unwavering belief in your abilities are well placed.
Let's hope that's enough to get us out, Alice mutters.
Yeah, I don't like, we told him too much already. This is bad.
One last matter before I send my envoy to investigate the interior,
Morin calls, pulling on the reins to guide his horse back towards the line of levied infantry.
I've obtained concerning missives from my informants that a guild revolt has overthrown the crown's representative. This is most displeasing development.
With that, the Baron gallops away. The medical workers are most rational at...
Quite so, Alice says. It'll back up all that we have said.
As you descend the staircase to await the arrival of Baron Morland's envoy, you see Alice pause on one of the wooden landings. Another faraway boom of thunder makes the banister of the wooden scaffold vibrate beneath your hand. Alice reaches to pat your torso, as if checking for something beneath her robe, then walks on. Oh, her torso. You do not find yourself waiting long. The sound of grinding mechanism stirs you from your position near one of the small piers and by the gathered guards. As you stand, you see the imposing gates crack open, wide enough for the lone, robed figure to step through. A desperate citizen, drawn to the sight by the noise, rushes forward as if to make an attempt to squeeze through the gap, only to halt as he spots the spears of the escorting soldiers. The figure steps farther inside, then signals above to the gatehouse. With a fresh groan of cogs, the gates close once more. As the hood of the robe is lowered, you recognize the face of the messenger who accompanied you to your previous rendezvous with the Baron.
Rhea, wasn't it?
You ask, seeing the rolled parchment in her hand. You add,
promoted to scribe now, I see.
Doctors, she replies, sounding a little sheepish.
I come at the Baron's insistence.
Don't worry, Alice says. We won't hold you responsible for reporting what you see.
Thank you, she says with some relief. I've been told to request that someone accompany me to the infirmary to answer any queries I may have.
Ioko's tusked mask turns towards Alice. You anticipate that your most capable theorist will accept this invitation, but she instead demurs.
You go, Ioko, she says. I could be needed here if the Baron returns with questions of his own.
Thought you'd be keen to present our work, Ioko says. All the same to me, though. Follow me, Rhea.
Something is amiss here. What's going on, Alice?
Yeah. Something is amiss here. What's going on, Alice?
Lower your voice, she whispers.
Alice waits until Ioko and Rhea are farther out of earshot before calling DeLucia. Your mercenary companion stops, leaning against the foot of the gatehouse stairway, and weaves her way through the assembled guards. Alice delves inside her robe and pushes a bound journal into Lucia's surprised hands.
Take this, she says. If our luck fails and the Baron assaults the town, I want you to get this out through the tunnels in the old quarter. It's a record of everything the three of us have learned about the waking death.
Lucia turns the tome over in their hands.
Why me?
They ask.
Why not escape this town yourself?
The quarantine, the physician replies.
I won't let his knowledge be lost, but the fewer people who breach the walls, the lower the risk of spreading further infection.
She points to Lucia's blade.
Of us all, you stand the best chance of escape. You spend days scouting lanes and alleyways, being Corvair's eyes. You can stay off the main streets.
They nod, placing the writings with stoic care inside their own jacket. Alice beckons them closer, describing the route through the underground caverns in hushed tones. Keep watch as your colleagues talk.
raised voices from farther down the street draw your ear. As you watch, the guild members begin to cheer and get to their feet. Walking toward you, her cane striking the earth with each stride, is the lone figure of Alviva Frit. Her progress is slowed by a steady procession of admiring townsfolk, every one of whom the council leader takes the time to stop and greet. You tap Alice on the shoulder, hoping that she has conveyed all she needs to Lucia. The mercenary delivers a quick nod of farewell, and you see them slip away between two buildings, no doubt positioning themselves to observe how matters unfold.
"Looks like the word of our deeds has reached the top," Alice remarks,
takes your arm, gripping hard enough that you feel the tips of her gloved fingers indented against your limb.
"Listen, Gamel, while we may still talk without restriction..."
She looks up, gauging the seconds before you will be interrupted.
"I know Oko has been pressuring you to withhold information from the Baron. He was hurt by the crown, and I understand his resistance, but..."
Her hands presses harder, her voice severe.
"I need to join the Fellowship, Gamel. Do you understand? We are to tell the Baron everything."
I'm not sure if... But before you can formulate a proper response, Alice has released your arm from hers and is moving to greet Alviva.
"I see the crown still directs boots to trample our fields,"
the guild leader says, motioning with her free hand towards the gates.
"Is there to be a peaceful withdrawal, or must we chase another tyrant from power?"
The idea is presented as if it were one that could succeed.
"An envoy of the Baron's is examining our medical work as we speak," Alice explains. "If proof of our treatments proves satisfactory, the siege will be lifted."
"And if not, the walls of this free town will be assailed."
"Well, we place our trust that it will not come to..."
"What have I told you? I believe we could win such a fight,"
Alviva asks.
"Our opponents have been camped in exposed condition, subsisting on fewer morsels than even our own resilient citizens. When I look beyond the walls, I do not see a bloodthirsty horde. I see frightened labourers and subjugated farmers pulled from their livelihoods and forced to serve at the Crown's behest."
"You describe every conflict," you say. "Labourer will fight labourer or suffer at the hands of their masters."
"Quite so,"
the guild leader replies.
"But even before the first council was convened, I instructed the guild to drop missives urging rebellion against the Baron in the few spots where patrols pass close to our walls."
"I cannot imagine many were found, let alone read," says Alice.
"Windier days were a challenge," she concedes. "Yet in this past cycle, we received our first reply. A group of soldiers defending the perimeter of the Northern Gate have been in communication with the guild sentries. Several deserted during the early snows. Others are ready to defect to our side."
"Conditions in the Baron's camp were degrading fast," you admit, recalling your visit. It is possible enough would wish to switch sides."
"This talk of insurrection is moot," Alice insists. "The envoy will confirm that we have done enough for the siege to be lifted."
Her tone suggests she has convinced herself of this at least.
"Nonetheless,"
Alviva says,
"should the need arise, the people stand ready."
As the conversation drifts towards more benign matters, we continue to ponder what has been said. Await the envoy's return. Storm clouds have begun to gather overhead by the time Ioka and Rhea are spotted by Alice. You get to your feet, finding them heavy with dread and resenting that every moment of your hard toil now rests on the opinion of one who does not even wear the mask of your profession.
"I've observed conditions at the infirmary, spoken with members of the clergy, and compared my findings to the Baron Morland told me you had conveyed as truth,"
Rhea says, unrolling a piece of parchment. "Diligent, at least," you think to yourself.
And what is your conclusion? Alice asked, exhibiting a remarkable calmness of tone.
I've gathered additional information, but I believe what you would have told the Baron to be accurate, she replies.
Tell us, you say. In your opinion, will this be enough for the Baron Morland to end the siege?
I cannot predict the Baron's whims, but all that I have seen suggests the plague is cured.
Rhea pauses for further consideration.
The development of a protective formula is a mark in your favour.
Then deliver your what you've found, Ayoko says, motioning to her parchment. And let's get a verdict, one way or the other.
Wait, Alice says. What are our prospects with the Fellowship?
The Fellowship?
Rhea asks.
Of Royal Physicians, she replies. We are to be inducted as a reward for our services.
The Envoy appears at a loss.
I know nothing of this, she says. But to receive such a recommendation from the Baron, you have to be a favourite subject indeed.
As Rhea prepares to depart, you are aware that this may be the final chance to ingratiate yourself further in Baron Morland's graces. Drops of rain begin to patter around your feet. I'm confident that our medical achievements are enough. I encourage Alice to allow our most significant discovery to be named after Baron Morland. I urge my colleagues to offer our brightest medical recruits to crown as future plague doctors. Number column must be pried from free from beneath the Baron's fist. I call Aviva's guild to arms.
Oh God.
I'm confident our medical achievements are enough. Yeah. Not doing anything else. To expect any more of us would be to demand the impossible, you say. If Morland still chooses to commit to attack, then his mind was already set before we stepped within the gates.
And the Fellowship, Alice asks, if Rhea has not heard of such an offer, is that mere falsehood too?
I've always said as much, Ayoko says, and I take no pleasure in it.
It does not seem strange to me that the Baron keeps such matters from his subjects, you reply, expressing a little more hope than the surgeon. But if after all we have done, he denies us places amongst the Fellowship, then I would concede that such an invitation was nothing more than a strand of dangled gold.
If you are ready,
Rhea says, signaling up to the sentry at the gatehouse. The gates begin to groan. As the doorway to the town swings... As the doorway to the town swings wider, you ready yourself to leave. Alice and Yoko move to do likewise, but the envoy shakes her head and points a finger square at your chest.
Just you, she says.
We all played our part, Alice says, clearly aggrieved. Should we not be able to make our case?
I'm sorry, Rhea says, but the Baron left me in no doubt.
Somebody has his favour, Ayoko remarks.
Since you should be our lone representative, Alice tells you, remember, give Lord Morland as much detail about their investigation as he desires.
As she speaks, you see the surgeon give a subtle shake of her head behind her. The gates fall quiet, replaced by the noise of heavier rains upon rooftops and muddied earth. Your cue for departure.
Lead on, you say to Rhea, wrapping your robes tight about you. Following the envoy over the threshold, you step beyond the walls of Thornback Hollow for the second time. You reflect upon the responsibility you carry with you, to the town, to your colleagues, and the decision that lies ahead. For a moment, the weight of your role feels almost overwhelming, until a misstep upon the dirt trail splatters a patterned spray of wet mud over the edge of your boot. The damp squelch tips you into a fit of laughter, drawing your mind away from the rigors of the hour. Your mirth lasts so long that Rhea gives you a glance of slight concern. Together you travel up a slight rise to where the yellow and black soldiers are assembled on the outskirts of the forest. Up close, you realize that many of these levied peasants are suffering from malnutrition. Some are even missing fingers and earlobes to the bite of frost. They are nevertheless
better armed and more numerous than those who remained to defend Thornback Hollow. With the envoy at your side, the rose part without complaint. Pass through. Rhea directs you past the crude battering ram, pointing to a temporary tent beyond the front lines. This shelter is little more than a square of material stretched out and supported by some simple poles. Beneath this cover, protected from the rain, and seated upon a chair whose lavish finery looks quite out of place, is Baron Morland. You feel a pang of sympathy for the poor bastard who has to haul that gaudy piece of furniture to the battlefield. Perhaps the honour belonged to the surly fellow standing guard outside the entrance. No sign of malnutrition there, you know.
Wait here,
your guide says, stooping beneath the canopy to deliver her report. You stand alone in the downpour, looking back across the brown landscape to the walls of the enclosed town. Another peal of thunder rolls its way around the peaks of the Cragtree Mountains. A few feet away, you see the Baron's lone horse strain at its moorings and clump the ground.
Come forth!
Rhea gives you a nod as she passes by on her way out.
Dreadful afternoon for a purge,
Morland says as you enter, waving his hands towards the miniature river, streaming off the cover of his makeshift tent.
Still, this rain can't persist forever, but let's do our best to prevent it coming to that, shall we?
Of course, your lordship.
Very good,
Morland smiles.
I recall again why I prefer your company to the other two.
Unfurling a rolled parchment, the Baron pretends to study the words he has already read. He cannot help but notice that Rhea has been unable to keep the document free from water damage.
Let us waste no more time on pleasantries or otherwise, he says. My envoy reports that you have indeed cured the waking death.
You are about to interject, but the Baron's raised hand directs you to be silent as he continues.
I am told that you have developed a protective elixir, but in quantities so small that the rate of new infection has not yet slowed.
With a nod, you confirm that this to be the case.
You have, it would appear, found and verified the source of the plague.
There is something else, you start to say, unable to maintain your silence any longer.
I have not finished, Doctor,
Morland says with a scowl.
You were encouraged to keep the crown's appointee in power. Instead, I learned that a rabble of timber labourers are commanding a Sybil Blake's stead.
A flash of faraway lightning illuminates the sky outside. The two of you pause, counting the beats, until the long roll of thunder has passed.
Now, in accordance with Crown law,
Morland continues,
it falls upon you to divulge every aspect of your medical discoveries, treatments and progress to me. I trust you are willing and prepared to do this.
I opt to alter and withhold just enough information to deny the Crown a full picture. You relay much of what you have learned in your investigation and treatment of the waking dead, but leave out or alter just enough of the medical specifics to make replication of your methods close to impossible. The Baron listens to your explanation, interjecting with questions at periodic intervals. You answer most with truth and pepper a few others with misleading details. As you bring your discussion to a close, you see Morland adjusting a jeweled ring upon his finger. His face carries a deep scowl.
Not only have you failed in your duties to the Crown, he says, you've opted to lie about what little you do know about this plague.
You open your mouth to protest, but he simply shouts over you.
I gave you a chance to salvage this debacle, at least provide the Crown with some knowledge of worth. Instead, you choose to conceal it in secrecy and half-truths.
The Baron shakes his head in anger.
I did not want it to come to this, truly, but your actions have left me with no choices. No choice.
He gestures to someone behind your shoulder. Powerful hands grip your arms, pinning you in place. For a larger man, the guard you saw outside the shelter has a near silent footfall. You heard nothing of his arrival.
Wait!
You cry, hoping still to bargain or reason your way out of danger. I see only one sure way to save my skin, betray Lucia by informing of their escape. I plead for clemency. The Baron will need a doctor to quarantine the soldiers. Patience, vessel, you shall be spared. So that, I think, would have been, if we had of maybe sided with the dweller. So let's, oh, but before we do this, let's have a look at our stats, actually. So physician, 32%, surgeon, 60, mysticism, 59, presence, 46, panache, 48, resilience, 54, 73% compassionate, 67 blasphemous, 60 populous, 84% principled, 57% jovial, 70% source of the contagion, 63% progress on the cure, spread of infection halted at 53, that's good. Arrest is 72, crown favor 59, popular support for Covey is 56, dweller influence is 47. Okay, and then let's see. So Alice, we went down to 35, so that's obviously to do with the fact that we are going against a lot of what she wanted. Ayoko is at 55, Lucia is 61, Sybil Blake at 27, Alviva 43, Covey 49, Qualm 44, and Dweller 47. Okay, and let's return to the game. Okay, yeah, so we're just gonna plead for clemency. We're not gonna betray anyone. I plead for clemency. The Baron will need a doctor to quarantine his soldiers. The soldiers who will burn Thornback Hollow, the words do not come easy as you think about those still trapped in the town. They too will need to be quarantined afterwards for signs of infection. The Baron raises a hand and the guard releases your arm. That is so, he replies. Then you shall have need of a physician, you say, gesturing at yourself. Please, spare me and I'll commit myself to your cause. I already have a physician, he says. She has worked with the Morland family for a generation and will oversee the quarantine. But surely, you protest as the guard's hand closes around your arms once more. Is Alice the... Surely I require the assistance of a doctor who failed to end the plague in Thornback Hollow? Morland asks. No, I think not. Wait, wait, you say again, your mind frantic, searching for the right words to subvert your fate. Take him away, the Baron commands, avoiding your gaze. Burn the body. There is a chance of infection. No, you shout as the guard hauls you back outside into the pouring rain. You struggle, but the man's arms are like a crushing pair of thongs. Bastard, you gasp, your chest almost squeezed of air. We tried everything. Your ankles and calves drag in the mud as you are pulled towards a tree stump behind the makeshift tent. The stain of blood is soaked deep into the wood. The guard pushes you to the dirt and draws a long sword from a scabbard. Kneel, head on block. From where you lie, muddied and doomed, you see the Baron mount his horse and begin to issue commands. The soldiers form up, ready to advance upon Thornback Hollow, spelling death for all who dwell within. You feel a sliver of hope that Alice's plan will see Lucy escape unscathed with what you have learned.
I said kneel.
The boot slams into your ribs, making you cry out in pain. It's done. I'm not going to run. I don't see a point in fighting him. I'm just going to do as he says. No point in prolonging the inevitable. You place your hands upon the stump, dragging yourself up to a position where you can lay your head against the executioner's block. All your efforts, all your plans have led to this injustice. You wonder if your death will ever be recorded, will even be recorded. With these remains, will there remain any proof that you even existed at all?
Stay still,
the man grunts, preparing to raise his blade.
Keep it clean.
Your heart pounds in your head. With your last dregs of courage, you shout your final words. Right now, I think it's just death to the crown, yeah. Assholes. bastards every last one of you is very close, but yeah, death to the crown. Okay, so not sure what was supposed to happen at the end, but the game seemed to be, I don't know, a little bit stuck or something, so I closed then, opened up again, then it was kind of on a blank page, and now we have, this is the end, so the blade falls, all is at an end. And that is the end, yes, so that was extremely enjoyable, very, very well written. Choices were difficult to make, which is kind of a testament to how well it was planned out too, because I'd already picked out how we were going to play, like how our character was going to be in it, but still there were a couple of obviously there were some choices that we could rule out straight away, but then there was so much gray in the others that we had a lot to do. We never really had an ambition for ourselves beyond curing the plague. Even at the start, where the whole thing about getting into the College of Surgeons was mentioned, that was never really anything that we were hoping for. If we had been offered it, we would have accepted, but it was not something, as I said, that we were expected or that we were doing anything for. We were just doing it to try and save the people, the town. Unfortunately, we didn't save the people, the town, because they ended up being exterminated anyway, including Ioko, Alice, Qualm, Alviva. Hopefully Lucy got out and got away. But yeah, we did what we could. But the crown is just, I guess it feels like crown's just this big machine that can just chew you up and spit you out. But yeah, very, very enjoyable. Even if you watch this, I'd recommend that you play it, because just being there inside and being the one that has to make the decisions completely changes everything. Because as I said, I watched Beriax play through it, and I definitely recommend that you go and check out his playthrough as well. He was kind of asking chat to vote on things and stuff, but at the same time, things happened in his playthrough that didn't happen in mine. It's but yeah, it's kind of it's really is a really good game, and hopefully we're going to see more from Peter in the future as well. That hopefully it's not kind of the last. It's not just a one-off kind of thing that he does. Hopefully there's more coming in the pipeline, because I know myself how writing can be. Having written for a video game myself, and also having written a lot of short stories that are going to be published, that it can be tough to get into the flow of writing, and then once you get out of it, it can be tough then to get back into it again. But yeah, hopefully Peter hopefully he did well out of the game, because he definitely deserved it, and I really want to see more from him in the future. But we're going to click all this at an end and see if there's anything after that. It's probably goes back. Oh, we've got an epilogue. Okay, well, we're going to read the epilogue, and then we shall end the series. So, Chapter 13, Epilogue. A long gull, its wings outstretched, dips and hovers upon the rolling sea breeze. You watch it descend, scanning the surface of the uneven harbour waves. The stench of salt, fish and filth dominates your senses. As the gull scoops a floppy prize into its maw, you try without success to clean your own mouth of the taste. Never should have followed Corvée to this wretched land, not for any price. Oh, so were Lucia. Ahead, stretching from one end of this damp inlet to the other, lie the docks of Grimm's Mouth. In all their woeful glory, the tall masts of merchant vessels bob upon the waves as labourers transfer containers of cargo to and from wooden holes. You watch a lone figure struggle with the rigging of the nearest ship, trying his best to untangle a viper's nest of ropes. Set back from the harbour, away from the boards and gangplanks, the ongoing bustle of traders and taverns provides a constant hubbub of cries, shouts and laughter. You look back toward the clear winter skies, peering once again upon the line of boats, hunting for the display for a particular flag. The exercise proves futile. You will have to get closer. As you descend into the throng, you feel the weighty slap of coin against your thigh. You press a hand to the pouch, keeping it close. Had to pay for passage, Fox. Don't fret, your journal still found its way to the right hands. Your yellow and black garments draw a few curious glances as you step around the coiled ropes and merchant's crates that seem to clutter the space around each individual dock. Switching outfits after your escape from Thormacollo would have been straightforward enough, but it can be beneficial to draw a little attention, especially when the authorities seek someone in quite different attire.
Or you!
On the other hand, sometimes the attention is far from desirable.
You, in Moorland's colours.
With a sigh and a quiet curse, you pause, you stretch your search for a ship's crest, and turn your attention to the hailing voice. It belongs to a dockyard butcher. He steps out from behind a stall of suspended graying carcasses to accost you further. He wipes two slabs of hands on a gore-smeared apron, then rubs his eyes at the back of a palm.
Well met, soldier,
he says, extending the other plate-sized hand. You keep your own at your sides, drawing a scowl and a grumble.
Suit yourself.
I'm in a hurry. What do you want?
You say, already on your heels, preparing for a swift resolution to this meeting.
Saw the colours,
he replies, pointing.
Serve the crown myself.
For a time.
Moreland's command.
The memories are apparently pleasant enough to return an expression of satisfaction to Budger's face.
Listen, were you at Thormacollo?
Maybe so,
you say with some caution. You ponder the blade concealed at your hip.
I knew it,
the man exclaims, playing a miserable selection of teeth.
I was saying to Berold.
He turns, yelling towards his colleague.
Oi, Berold!
A pause.
Berold!
The butcher's viscerate, stained hand clamps on your shoulders, his udder jabbing towards you like a fast sausage.
Like I said, Thormacollo.
Your forceful shove brings the man's sentence to a premature end. Taken by surprise, the air driven from his chest. He tumbles over backward, releasing your shoulder from his grasp as he disappears over the harbour's edge. Too much attention. Vacate the area in haste. You've taken flight before the splash, commotion in your wake.
Man over!
Someone shouts.
Fetch a rope!
Another demands. A few more strikes of your soles against the ground, and the voices are indistinguishable from the rest of dockside tumult. You weave between groups of harbour folk workers, skipping and twisting around stallkeepers and patrons, coin pouch bouncing at your side, until you are content to believe that none have followed your path. Leaning upon a container of sturdy design, you regain your breath and observe your changed surroundings. There, atop one of the masts, you spy a golden sun upon a verdant background. A woman in matching robes of green and gold stands on deck, directing scurrying subordinates through the intricacies of seafaring maintenance. Needing no further cues, you hurry across the vessel's gangplank. A pair of labourers hauling a large chest give you a passing glance as you climb aboard, but nobody says a word until you present yourself on board.
You there? You're not one of my crew,
the robe woman says, her breath forming a soft cloud in the bracing sea air. She steps your way, adjusting her unusual naval hat.
If you're offering cargo, you're too late.
Hold full. Goods are flowing. Now that the blockade at Thornburg Hollow is down.
Your flag, you say, gesturing upward at the fluttering material.
Do you sail to Salvessa? With the tide?
The captain nods.
Need any more hands?
She looks you up and down.
I see you can fight.
Her head tilts towards the hip, where your blade rests beneath the stolen garb.
You hide it well, but I haven't survived this long by ignoring such things.
I'm no mercenary, you say, your head pulled low by bitter regret.
Not anymore. Shame. Always room for another blade. What else can you do?
I can pay, you reply, producing the pouch of coin and teasing its weight in your hand. Captain raises her eyebrows.
Always room for generous passengers too, although...
Her stare lingers upon your clothes and she frowns.
You won't fight, yet you wear the garments of a soldier. You a deserter.
I fought at Thornburg Hollow. As you've heard, that battle is finished. My levy service is over. She scoffs.
Not much of a battle, from what I've heard. More of a massacre.
Her hand motions to your pouch.
Push this right up. Crown soldiers pay double.
We hadn't settled on the price to double, you complain.
Then let's save time. The cost is whatever coin is in that bag. You wish to travel, hand it over.
Captain holds out her hand. Reluctant exhalation of breath, you relinquish everything you were paid for Alice's journal.
Don't have any spare cabins, but...
Oh, it's her.
Don't have any spare cabins. But you can sleep with the cargo, she says, gesturing around the deck, with pouch in hand. You're free to walk the deck. Just try to stay out of the way.
With lighter stride, you find your way to the boat's prow and rest your elbows against the wooden rail, gazing back toward the buildings of Brimsworth. Gentle waves lap against the hull. Another gull cries overhead. A painted sign outside the dockside tavern swings back and forth in the breeze. You read the name. The Resplendent Wolf. A laugh, short and touched by sorrow, escapes your throat. I did what you asked. Journal, it's safe. Whatever comes of that, I hope it brings you some solace. You, the boar, the fox, all you bloody masks. You pull your sword from your scabbard, extend your arm, holding the weapon over the water. No more mud, no more bloodshed, no more fighting for somebody else's cause. You let the blade go, turning away from the splash. End. Okay, we hope you enjoyed playing Mask of the Plague Doctor. Scale of 1 to 10, how likely would you be to recommend this game to a friend? Most likely, I'm recommending to all of you friends watching now, go get this game. It doesn't matter whether you've seen a lot of the story here, you're definitely going to enjoy your journey. Just certainly more to be discovered than what I did. And I'm sure that you would have made different decisions to me. Thanks for playing. Choice of Games release new games like this one on a regular basis. Type your email address below. Okay, yeah, I'll do that later. Yeah, so as I said, hopefully we're going to see more from Peter Parrish. And if we do, I'm definitely going to be playing it on the channel. So that is the end of this video and also the end of the series. Hope you have enjoyed. If you enjoy games like this, story-driven stuff, you should definitely check out my playthrough of The Innsmouth Case, which is a Lovecraftian-style choose-your-own-adventure. And also... my playthrough of Cultist Simulator, which again is very story driven in that as well. There's also going to be more content like this coming up on the channel, so keep your eyes out for that. I would also recommend that you go and check out Variax either on YouTube or on Twitch. Both links for both of those are somewhere down there in the description as well. And that is it for me. So hope you have enjoyed. Hope you've been safe out there, and hope to see you on another one. Goodbye. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, maybe consider hitting the subscribe button there on the right, or checking out some other videos here on the left.
or perhaps you might even share with some friends.